Good morning. Grateful to see all of y'all here in spite of it being just a little bit dreary, and especially those who are joining us by stream. This is the time that we have Maplewood's top
five.
You're getting better each and every week. I'll tell you what, one of these days I'm just going to hand you the sheet and let you do it. What do you think? Well, we're going to start off with an opportunity that's just kind of come up over the last few days that's involving Danny over at Enid Baptist Church. He wants to make you aware of an opportunity to go and hear some good praise and worship this evening.
Morning, everyone. This evening at 6 o'clock, Enid is having their first Sunday service since all this COVID started. It's going to be a Singspiration service starting at 6 o'clock. Several of the folks that Enid will be singing. Eric, are you singing? Other than with us? Okay. Several folks from Enid are singing. The boys will be singing. I'll be singing with a group that I sing with at Enid, and Eric will be in that group. And Debbie's going with me, and we're going to sing a song. So if you don't have plans tonight at 6 o'clock, come on over to Enid. You know where it's at Flint Hill Road in 0421, right there on the corner. You can't miss it. It's the biggest church on the corner. It's the only church on the corner. But come on over at 6 and enjoy some worship. They're very strict about their COVID criteria, just like we are, so they've got all that handled so you can feel safe in coming. So come and worship with us if you can.
Amen. And they understand about the Experiencing God group, so anybody in the Experiencing God group, when we finish up around 6:30 or so, if they want to head over that way, you'll be welcome as well. Couple other things I want to bring you up today. We've already had one week of early voting, and when Penn and I got a chance to go, guess what? There were nearly 5,800 ballots already cast. I think they said that in 2016 in Yadkin County for early voting, there were just over 7,000 ballots cast. I would tend to think they are well on their way of surpassing that because we have 1 week left. It finishes up on Saturday at 3 o'clock, and then, of course, Election Day is the following Tuesday. I hope and pray that you've taken your civic responsibility to go and cast your vote. And as the sign says, the Bible is life's ultimate election guide. Amen and amen. How many of y'all like to kind of stay in the loop or stay up to date? Don't forget that this Tuesday is the last Tuesday of the month, and every last Tuesday of the month we have our prayer conference call. For lack of a better word, it's the opportunity to stay up to date. You'll call in at 514. You see the number there, and we'll have a chance to kind of just spend some time together. This coming Wednesday evening down in the fellowship building, we passed out last week our 2021 ministry budget. There is an increase. That increase is to help us reach out into our community and do more outreach. Everything else has pretty well stayed the same or decreased. And so we try to be good stewards of what God has entrusted us. Teresa and the finance committee will present that budget and answer all of your questions. And if you need a copy of the budget or that community partnership when you leave this morning, I'll be glad to share that with you. And then don't forget, next Sunday afternoon, beginning at 2 o'clock, there's going to be a community prayer walk beginning at the postal office in the parking lot there, going to five different strategic locations, ending up at the courthouse as our way to blanket our community in prayer. And this comes as a response to Franklin Graham's prayer march in Washington, D.C. Chris Hooser and South Oak Ridge are kind of leading the way on that. So you help us spread the word. Are you about ready to worship? Are you on the edge of your seat? Have you gotten your voice clear? I'm glad one person's laughing. Curtis is going to come and share a few thoughts, give you an idea to begin to meditate on as we think about this, our seventh habit of our healthy churches. And then Danny, the praise ensemble, will again lead us in worship. Curtis, you come.
Man, I tell you, don't you guys just love that? You get really excited, and then he's like, and Curtis is coming still. And then we will get started. But just a couple of things, a couple of reminders that we've gotten out of the habit of talking about, especially for those that are joining by stream. If you want to stay up to date every time we go live here, just hit the subscribe button. And if you're wondering, if you're sitting at home, am I in the right place? Well, if you're watching this, you're in the right place. Just hit subscribe. And the second thing is, as some of you may have noticed, may not have noticed, some of you may have had questions about offering. There's an offering bucket as you come in, and then there's an offering bucket. If you didn't get the chance to drop it off there, you can drop it off there as you're leaving. But what I wanted us to kind of think about together today is, what does it look like or mean to lead from the position of a servant? And then what does it look like to develop others to do the same? Join with me as we pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we come to you this morning. Lord, so excited to join in worship together. Lord, join in worship to you. Father, to experience you anew today. Father, I thank you for the gift of humor, the gift of just being able to be in community with one another. And Father, the ability to come here, Lord, and just worship. I pray that you would watch over our time together today. Lord, that we would see you in everything that we do. Lord, that we would seek to glorify, honor, and lift high the name that is above all names. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
As we begin our service this morning, I would just like to ask you to meditate on, as we sing these songs, what it means to really serve Christ. If we want to really serve Him, we have to keep our eye on Him. We have to keep our ears open to what He wants us to hear. And He'll show us the way He wants us to go. It may not be the way we want to go, but we want to ask Him to show us the way He wants us to go. So let's worship together, meditate on that this morning.
Say that. me your ways, that I may walk with you. Show me your ways. I put my hope in you. The cry of my heart is to love you more, to live with the touch of your hand, stronger each day. Show me your way. Let's sing it just one more time. Show me your ways, that I may walk with you. Show me your ways. I put my hope in you. The cry of my heart is to love you more, to live with the touch of your hand, stronger each day. Show me your ways.
Amen.
Talked about, and Jordan, if you'll follow me when I go along with these, please. I want to continue to ask you to pray for Francis. Thank you for the marvelous way that you have just showed them that you're thinking of them and praying for them. For Carl, he has not had any negative effects to the immune therapy, and he is so grateful. In fact, Todd ran into him. He was coming one way, and Todd was going the other, and they got a chance to visit and socialize for just a few moments. I want to just ask you to continue to pray for Jeff Meadows. We hadn't shared this need. I've got a little bit of an echo. But this is HL's son-in-law. He is married to Lee, and he has been recently diagnosed with prostate cancer and is preparing for that surgery. And so if you'll be praying for him, thank you for your continued prayers for my father-in-law, Jerry Parks. He did have that procedure on Thursday, and we just need to continue to pray because now we're waiting for all of the information that's coming from that. And there's some concern. And so a couple things that I want to ask you. First of all, if you'd like to drop him a note, you see his address there, 4970 Jerry Parks, 4970 Denton Road, Thomasville, 27360. Now, can I just be real frank with you? I'm going to ask you to send him a card or a note. Jerry's a wonderful person, been a great father-in-law to me. Jerry doesn't go to church very much. And what I'd love to see happen is I'd love to see him overwhelmed by those who believe in the healing power of God. He's had some neighbors and some friends pass away recently, and we're just trying to boost his spirits. And so if you'd help us with that, we would be most grateful. We're finding that it's more and more difficult for him to get around even within his own house. They've had to extend his oxygen tube. And so if you have one of those seats that can go above the toilet, or if you have a seat that can go in the shower, we would be most helpful if you could let us borrow one of those. If you'll see Penny, she would be so grateful for that because these are some things that we're needing to help him make it a little easier for him to get around. He's starting to fall some, and that certainly causes some concern. Thank you for your continued prayers for Bradley. I just felt led Wednesday evening to go down and spend some time with them, and I got there about the right time. They had just gotten in from all the things going on. He had his port inserted on Friday. They'll do the collection of stem cells on Monday, and then sometime later in the week he'll have that extremely strong dose of chemo that will basically wipe his entire body out of his immune system, and then they'll begin to put those stem cells back in. And so it's going to be a long, tedious process. He'll be somewhat in isolation for a period of time, and so we just need to be praying for him. But here's what I want you to know. Christy has said over and over and over, and she sent me a text late last night, please tell the people at Maplewood we wouldn't be where we are today without their prayers and support. And so we are so grateful for all that you've been doing. I'm blessed to see Eric and Sheila here today. We have been praying for you, Sheila, not only with your eyes, but also with all the things going on with your heart. I just want to continue to remind you of that and let you know that we've been praying for you. I am so grateful. You might have seen last week, Miss Suzanne raised that hand and said, I got a prayer need. And it was an update on Miss Lena Gale. She just had a scan recently, and it came out wonderful. And that was some very optimistic news on her behalf, and so we're thankful for that. You might not know the name of Richard Young, but this is Velma Slater's son-in-law, married to Karen. He's big in Christian music, Premier Productions. And we found out that he's going to have some pretty significant heart bypass surgery tomorrow, as well as a heart valve. And here's the crazy thing. He's a runner and didn't really feel a lot going on. And so the doctor has simply said that based on what they found, it was your running that has helped you to this point. And so just be in prayer for him. I let him know that we're praying and lifting him up to the Lord in prayer. Now, the two Carells are related. Howard Carell, he and his family went to our church when we were down in Jerusalem. He passed away of a pretty significant heart attack. He had gotten up some leaves. A friend went down to take his golf cart back to his house, came back, and he was slumped over his little lawnmower. And then the Cooter Corral, if you've ever gone down 601 toward Salisbury, right before you get to Jerusalem Baptist Church, as you go by Greasy Corner, you see this little lot that has all these cars and usually has some sheriff and police cars and other things. That was his lot, his garage. He passed away after contracting COVID and caused him to have double pneumonia. And so please continue to pray for his family. I just want to ask you to pray for, I can't pronounce her last name, Mom, but the Roby Lassane. This is some dear friends of Mom's, the former pastor, Steve Rumley's grandson, 22 years old, and he took his own life last week. And so we just need to pray. His dad works with Samaritan's Purse. His mom has been very involved in a lot of community ministries up that way in the Boone area. And they had a tremendous celebration of his life over at Mount Vernon. So if you'll lift them up to the Lord in prayer, that would mean so much to us. Now, we've got some great things to celebrate. Are you ready? Remember I told you that Ryan and Tiffany were going to go find out what that little baby is? They were going on the anniversary of their wedding. And guess what they found out? Coming in March. Now, they've got a new address. They have just recently, this weekend, going to be moving to Moxville, 325 Gwynn Street. So if you want to drop them a little note, you are welcome to do that. And then we got the privilege to go and celebrate Will and Diane Spittler's 50th wedding anniversary last evening on behalf of the church. Because of COVID, they could basically only keep their celebration to their family and close friends. And so we kind of represented the church on our behalf, and so we are grateful that their actual wedding anniversary is the 31st. But now you see them when they got married, and then you see them last evening, and so we're certainly grateful for that. I want to tell you another celebration that I am excited about. On the 8th of November, we as a church are going to have the chance to set aside Curtis for the gospel ministry. And I just want to tell you something. Having experienced that for myself, that is a very sacred and special time. Because it's a time when you begin to recognize what you've already sensed in your heart for many, many months, and possibly even years, that God has called you to serve Him and to give your life to Him full time. And so He recently had the Associational Ordination Council, along with our deacons, sat down with Him, and we have just been so excited what God is doing. So on the 8th of November at 3 p.m., we will have that ordination service, and you'll be invited, and we're also going to be streaming that, again, because we do have a limited number that can come, and we're looking forward to all that that service will mean and represent. There will be some light refreshments that are going to be served to you in the narthex when all of that is said and done. Now, here's what I also want to let you know. It is that time of the year again. And what is that? Shoebox time. I want you to watch this little video from Franklin Graham, and I'm going to come up and share another thought with you.
This year has been a pandemic year. Children are hurting all over the world. People are afraid. Families are scared. People have lost their jobs. They don't know where to go, what to do. They don't know what hope they have for the future. Well, I want every child to know that God loves them, that God has not forgotten them, and that He cares for them very much. And when you pack a shoebox and send it to Operation Christmas Child, it gives us an opportunity to give that box to a child and do it in Jesus' name. Can you just imagine the hope and the thrill and the joy of when a kid opens up a lid like this and all these toys are in it? It's an incredible gift. And so I just want to say thank you. We need your help this year more than we've ever needed it because of the pandemic. It's just going to create a lot more opportunity. Thank you, and God bless you. And remember, pray for the children of the world.
So you probably didn't pick up your box. We've got some of the plastic boxes as well as the cardboard boxes. All the information that you need is inside. If you're looking for something specific as far as an age group, we do have some handouts on the table, or you can go to our Facebook page and find the link to where you can go to the Samaritan's Purse website and get that information as well. Now, here's what I want to encourage you. When you leave this morning, go around and go back in that outside door, and you can pick up as many boxes as you need. And our in-gathering is going to be the 15th of November, the third Sunday of November. Now, because of all the changes, there might be some confusion. Well, what can we put in the box and what can we not put in the box? I want to wrap up today with a little brief video to give you some thoughts.
With a towel and a bowl, with a heart that is humble, I will do my master's will, as I let my own will crumble. If I claim to follow Christ, His love demands a sacrifice. to embrace the servant's role with a towel and a bowl. I am called to be a servant, to display the Father's grace. I am called to show the love once shown to me, and not to stand in judgment, but to give myself away. If I want to be like Jesus, I must start upon my knees, with a towel and a bowl, with a heart that is humble. I will do my master's will, as I let my own will crumble. If I claim to follow Christ, his love demands a sacrifice, to embrace the servant's role with a towel and a bowl. If his hands could offer mercy there upon a rugged cross, then my hands must reach in love to meet your need. To serve as his disciple, regardless of the cost, if I want to be like Jesus, I must start here on my knees, with a towel and a bowl, with a heart that is humble. I will do my master's will, as I let my own will crumble. If I claim to follow Christ, his love demands a sacrifice, to embrace the servant's role with a towel and a bowl. With a towel and a bowl, with a heart that is humble, I will do my master's will, as I let my own will crumble. If I claim to follow Christ, his love demands a sacrifice, to embrace the servant's role with a towel and a bowl.
Take your Bible, Danny. Thank you so much. And turn to the Gospel of John. The Gospel of John. We're going to be in the 13th. Chapter. I want to just kind of take a moment. As you know, we're now on the seventh habit. As we're on the seventh habit, those first several habits had to do with our relationship with the Lord, about experiencing His presence, about spiritual disciplines, about worship. These last several have had to do with our relationship to one another, that we are to be in community, that we ought to have loving and caring relationships. And then today we're going to begin to look at this little thought. What does it mean to learn to serve like Jesus? Learning to serve like Jesus. Let me see if I can kind of set the stage for us. Now, you don't have to be a rocket scientist, but you have to just watch either the news or your feed or the newspaper. And what do you begin to see? you begin to see a large rise in violence. In fact, the largest 50 cities recently surveyed found they are all seeing staggering rises in violence. Some are doubled. In fact, a 24% increase so far through June of this year over last year, the Wall Street Journal reports. They have reported 3,612 murders across our country so far. And here's what I want you to grasp. Police officers are even getting what? Ambushed. Now, here's the sad part. As they're getting ambushed, we hear more and more about officers what? Being murdered. In fact, if I'm not mistaken, 65 officers have died in the line of duty through like July of this year. So can I ask you a question? What's motivating all this kind of behavior? And whatever is motivating this kind of behavior, what role do you and I need to take to counter this violence and hatred and fear? What can you and I, as God's people, through our own choices, words, and actions, do that would help build and strengthen the communities in which we live? Because you and I know that this fear-based hatred and violence are completely opposite of how God calls you and I as healthy disciples to live. I believe the answer is in today's message. God has called us to what? Serve. To serve our communities, because a healthy disciple exhibits Christ-like servanthood. Christ-like servanthood. Go to this verse of Scripture with me, and you'll see what I'm talking about. So Matthew 20:28, just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as what? Ransom for many. Now, if that wasn't enough, let's see what the Bible tells us in the book of Mark. Mark chapter 10, Jesus called them together and said, you know that those who are regarded as rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their high officials exercise authority over them. Not so with what? You. Instead, whoever wants to be great among you must be your servant. Whoever wants to be first must be your slave. Can I ask you a question? When you were younger, as you were thinking about what you wanted to become, when you grew up, how many of you imagined this little thought? When I grow up, I want to be a servant. Anybody? Rick Warren tells us in his book, Purpose Driven Life, this little statement. If I have no love for others, no desire to serve others, and I'm only concerned about my needs, I should question whether or not Christ is real in my life. For you see, a person who has had a life-changing experience of salvation with Jesus will be a person who naturally wants to serve. Why? Because now the Holy Spirit lives within you. Henry Nouwen went on to say this, no Christian is a Christian without being a minister. Whatever form the ministry takes, the basis is always the same, to lay down one's life for others. Let's just stop for a second. How does that ring in your life? If I got the opportunity to hang around the people who hang around you, would they characterize your life in that manner? Would they say that you are a person who takes the towel and the basin and is always willing to serve? Or would they say that it seems to them that you're the person who always wants to be the first in line? You're always the person who wants to be noticed. You're the one who always wants the attention upon yourself. I think we haven't gone very far in the message, have we? That we begin to have a conflict. Because the conflict is, if that's what's happening, then there must be something contrary to God's word going on in our heart. Because if we're truly living a life after Christ, then there ought to be something of what we've already read demonstrated and displayed in how we live. That brings us to our text, John chapter 13. And again, as I say each and every week, if you're able, stand with me, but if you're not, you can simply sit where you're at. John chapter 13, and we're going to begin reading in verse 12. Now, all of this has already taken place. He's already washed the disciples' feet. He's had that experience with Peter. And now he says these words. When he had finished washing their feet, He put on his clothes and returned to his place. Do you understand what I have done for you? He asked. You call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that is what I am. Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you should also wash one another's feet. For I have set you an example that you should do as I have done. I tell you the truth, no servant is greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. Now that you know these things, you'll be blessed if you what? Do them. Strong as we pray, Father, may we be the kind of people who put into practice what it is you have demonstrated. And may we do that to draw others unto yourself. And we ask this in your name. Amen and amen. And you may be seated. If we had more time, I could go back in the early part and get you to think about some things. But here's the essence of it. What you need to know is this. In Jewish custom, it was the custom of the host to always have a container in which people could wash their feet. Because how did they get around in that day and time? They walked everywhere they went. And when they walked everywhere they went, they walked with sandals, and their feet got very dirty in the day. So it was a custom when you came into a person's home that there would be a towel and a basin that you could wash your own feet. Now, if they were a person of great means, there would actually be a servant there. So as you think about this experience, who's the host of this meal? Jesus is the host, right? He's the one that's called them together. He's having what we call this Last Supper. And all of a sudden, when all of this is going on, where's the servant? There is no servant. There is no servant there. And all of a sudden, as they are eating, Jesus then prepares himself to become the very servant that they had expected to see. Now, here's what I want you to grasp. Why did the disciples not notice that? Why did the disciples not realize that what was going on was contrary to what they had always experienced? You know why? Because if you look at the Gospels, they were all wrapped up in who was going to be what first. Who was going to sit on the right and who was going to sit on the left? Who was going to be the greatest? They were all wrapped up and self-absorbed in themselves. And Jesus understood that he didn't need to teach them anything. He needed to what? Show them what a servant really looked like. So he took up a basin. Now, the understanding we have is that he removed his outer garment, whatever he might have had on, and he wrapped around him a towel. And then one by one, he began to wash their feet. Now, they're not sitting in chairs, are they? They're reclining, and their feet are behind them. So he washes each and every one of their feet. He comes to Peter, as you know, and Peter says, what? No, you can't wash these feet. Jesus said, listen, if you don't let me wash your feet, you'll have no part of me. He wasn't talking so much about salvation as he was talking about what God wanted him to be about. So then what does Peter say? Well, don't just wash my feet, wash everything about me. Now, you need to understand that there are some denominations who have taken this experience of foot washing and actually want to make it an ordinance like baptism and the Lord's Supper. There's a problem with that because this experience of foot washing is mentioned nowhere else in the New Testament. There's no other examples of the early church or others who are conducting foot washing. Now, not to say that you shouldn't think about the overall spirit of what that says, but Jesus didn't need for this to become an ordinance like baptism and the Lord's Supper. He wanted this to be a demonstration of what it meant to follow after him. So let's go to the text we just read. In verse 12, Jesus poses for us a question. And the question is very pivotal because he wants to make sure that what he just did, his disciples didn't miss. Look what it says. When he had finished washing their feet, he put on his clothes and returned to his place. And he said, do you understand what I have done for you? Have you ever had somebody that's younger follow you in what you're doing and you turn to them and said, now, do you understand everything I just did? You do that for one reason, and that is to make sure they what? Got it. Would you agree? Now, as he did that, he followed that up with what I call a powerful declaration. A powerful declaration in verses 13 and 14. You call me teacher and Lord, and you're right, for so I am. If I then, your teacher and Lord, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. Now, just think with me for a second. The disciples have just experienced this firsthand, and now their master teacher says, I want you to make this a way of life. I want you to wash not only one another's feet, but others' feet as well. Now, can I just be real candid with you? I don't mind rubbing someone's hands. I don't mind patting them on the shoulder. But now, if you stuck your feet in front of me, I might say, what are you thinking? And then furthermore, some of us are funny about people messing with our feet, right? But Jesus is saying, because of what I've shown you, the lowliest of the low, washing one's foot, I want you to have the same attitude as well. And then on top of that, he makes what I call a powerful punchline. It's in verse 15. He says, I have set you an example that you should do as I have done. In other words, don't do as I say, but do as I have demonstrated for you to do. If you had to put all of this thought in a motto, it would be this, right? Actions speak louder than words. I can just tell you right now, I've been married to Penny 30 years, and we've picked about this one another. I can tell her all day long, sweetheart, I just want you to know I love you, I love you, I love you. There wouldn't be anything I wouldn't do for you. And all of a sudden, she began to make some, I don't want to say demands, but some requests. She would call them hints. They might be on a little post-it note. They might be in a comment. They might be in a little thought. And as those comments or thoughts are shared, if I'm not following up with them, sooner or later, if I say to her, sweetheart, I just want you to know, I love you as much today as the day we stood in front of all those people and I took your hand and claimed you unto myself as my beautiful bride, she'd say, liar, liar, pants on fire. What do you mean? I'm telling you everything that's true. No, you're not, because I have asked you to do bump, 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 and you hadn't even thought about one of them. You see, actions speak louder than words. Agreed? Now, furthermore, a person's actions will tell you everything you need to know about who they are. Now, I'm not trying to get into this to get side rail, but let me ask you a question. Isn't that the problem with politics today? They'll promise you the moon, but they never deliver. And so what they do for you says volumes about what they're really willing to believe about you. So let me spend a few minutes kind of helping you begin to think. If we're supposed to learn to serve, how this Christ-like servanthood, this towel and this basin, this towel and this bowl theology, what should it be characterized by? What should it motivate us to be like that? First and foremost, you need to understand something. You were created, guess what? For service. You were created for service. Look at this verse of Scripture in the book of Ephesians. For we are God's handiwork. I always like to say masterpiece. Created in Christ Jesus to what? To do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. In other words, you weren't just created to look good. You were created to what? Do good works. When? In advance. Before you even a thought in your mom and dad's eye, God has placed in each and every one of us the desire to serve and to be servants. Now, as you begin to think about that, I believe with all my heart, that's the reason why there are so many people out there in the world today that have what I call this emptiness, this thing that's missing. Because this passage of Scripture in the book of Ephesians reveals that long before any of us were born, God placed in us service. That's what we were what? Wired to do. Now, you know this little saying, a couch potato. Now, can I ask you a question? When you think of the image of a couch potato, who comes to mind? Please don't say your spouse. But a couch potato, as you know it, is a person who takes little or no exercise and they tend to watch a lot of television. And we tend to see them with what? Something to drink and a pile of chips, and they got the remote in their hand, right? And they're kind of reared back in the recliner. Now, here's what you need to understand. As much as we laugh about a couch potato, I think there's something similar that's going on in the church. We don't call them couch potatoes, but we call them instead pew potatoes. Pew potatoes. And a pew potato is a Christian who makes their way into the church at every opportunity to simply sit and watch what is going on while snacking on their religion. Now, you ponder that thought for just a minute. They come anytime the doors are open, but they sit and watch what's going on while they snack on their religion. They come and watch what's going on, but never involve themselves in the work of God's kingdom. You could just tell them until you're blue in the face all the things that are needed to be done, and it'll never dawn on them that they're the one that's supposed to get up and do it. Because their attitude is what? Somebody else will take care of that. That's not up to me. You ought to even be grateful that I've chosen to come and be here today. Because all they're doing is taking up place in God's house. Now, like the couch potato, which eventually suffers from ill health, the body of Christ suffers from ill health when we allow ourselves to become nothing but pew potatoes. Because, friends, we were created for service. Secondly, when we serve, it proves we belong to Christ. It proves we belong to Christ. Look at Romans 7:14. Therefore, my brothers, you also were put to death in relation to the law through the crucified body of the Messiah, so that you may belong to one another, to him who has raised from the dead, that we may but bear fruit for God. You see, when you and I serve, we are identifying ourselves with whom? Christ, our Lord and Savior, who set the standard for serving. So whether we're serving in what they call small and insignificant ways, we are doing things in such a way that we are identifying that we belong to Christ. And in so doing, we begin to show others where our personal self-worth lies. Not in titles or positions, but in Christ. In Christ. Now, it might not be a big thing, but I can just tell you this, there are a lot of things around this church that are taking place that are outside the observant eye. As an example, last week, what did we do? We had the Lord's Supper. So what had to happen? Someone had to prepare it. Someone had to get it ready. Someone had to put it in the trays, right? Someone had to be willing to help clean up afterwards and then have enough for us to serve in the drive-through time. Here's what you need to understand. There are people that every time we get ready to do that are ready to get it ready. When we have someone to come to faith in Christ and we want to have a baptism, does the baptistry fill itself up? Does it fill itself up? Now, Robert and Brian have almost made it where it can fill itself up. As they say, it's pastor proof. All I got to do is push a button and make sure the water is on. And it will fill itself up and it will turn itself off. As long as I've remembered to put the little thing in the stopper. Right? But somebody has to do that. Somebody has to come and lay the towels out and the bags for the wet clothes. See, these are simple and what might be considered insignificant things. But when done, and done in the way God wants us to do them, it identifies that we belong to Christ. Thirdly, serving others is a way that we get a chance to serve God directly. Look what this passage tells us in Matthew 25. And the king will answer, truly I say to you, as you did to one of the least of these my brothers, you've done it directly to me. When you and I humbly and willingly serve others, it is though we are serving God himself. Here's the problem. The problem is sometimes it's tempting to begin not to be humble, instead trying to be perfect. And most of us, if we're really honest, never trust people who claim to be perfect, right? We'd rather a person be a little flawed, warts and all. Those are the kind of people that we desire to identify with. My mom is one who every time we go by the streets in Winston-Salem And she sees that person on the side of the road. Jimmy, stop. I want to do something for them. Mom, I've seen them for the last 3 weeks. I don't care. I want to do something for them. Now, you understand what I'm talking about. Now, we ought not to be callous, right? Because there might be legitimate individuals who are in need. I was sitting in the McDonald's parking lot the other day when we were waiting on the outcome of Jerry's surgery, and a lady walked up and said, sir, you couldn't spare enough money for me to get a tea, could you? I said, absolutely. Let's go get one. See, instead of her giving them, I was sitting in McDonald's parking lot, instead of me giving her the money, I said, let's go get one. I'll be glad to buy you one. You see, sometimes what people just need to know is that we truly do care. And as we express that care, what are we ultimately doing? We are ministering and serving the risen Lord himself. And then next, it makes life more meaningful. Look at Mark chapter 8, verse 35. If you try to hang on to your life, you'll lose it. But if you give up your life for my sake and for the sake of the good news, the gospel, you will what? Save it. Can I tell you something I'm really excited about? And I'm saying this to you, not to brag, but to ask you to pray that the efforts that are about to be done might be done in a way that truly impacts the lives of others. Project Rack got together the other day, and guess what we're going to have the opportunity to do? We're going to have the opportunity to impact the lives of 75 different people in Yakin County through our school system as they give them a Thanksgiving box full of all kinds of goodies this Thanksgiving. They're going to be using the school counselors and those who might really know the legitimate needs of the children. Now, 75 boxes really pales in comparison to the entire need of our county. But here's what we need to understand. It's a start. Amen? I also want to tell you something. I'm so grateful that God has burned the heart of those who are part of this outreach ministry that we ought to be about doing something rather than just talking about something. A couple weeks ago, we were down experiencing God, and we were sharing about the ongoing, ever-present needs of those like Shannon, like Bradley and Crystal, and like others who seem to always have these things that are happening because their illness, their recovery, their situation is long-term. Francis, Carl, and many others. And all of a sudden, out of that conversation, an individual left that room and said, I could do something about that. And they contacted Sandra with Project Rack, and they said, I'm going to go ahead and begin to put some freezer meals together that a person could pull out of the freezer and put in the crock pot. I'm going to give them exact instructions of what to do. I'm going to get them all the ingredients. All they have to do is put all that literally into a crock pot. And as they put that into a crock pot, then they can walk away and the rest of the day, and that meal will be there for them when they get ready to eat it that evening. What do you think? And this person has taken upon themselves to go and do that. I want to tell you something. When I learned that, I wanted to shout. Because you know what happened? A person didn't wait for a committee to have a discussion and then for a vote and then for approval. They just said, you know what? I hear of a need and I can do something to meet that need. Because as they meet that need, what do you think they begin to see in their own life? That their life has meaning. Meaning. I can just tell you this. I can always tell who is the leaders when you watch to see if they're willing to do the small stuff. Now, I got to be real honest with you. I've been in ministry now almost 40 years. 40 years I've been in ministry. And I'll be real candid with you. I've seen a lot of people who had positions of leadership, but they never exhibited qualities of servanthood. When it came time to eat, they were in the front of the line. When it came time to clean up, they were gone. When it came time to do, you couldn't find them. But you take away their position, you had another thing coming. Now, friends, listen to me. That ought not to be so, should it? You and I ought to be the ones, if we have any leadership about us, and if Christ has done anything for us, we ought to be the ones serving the most with the towel and the bowl. Because you see, I've learned that when you serve in that fashion, you truly find out what it means to give your life away. And finally, the reason why we ought to serve, probably which is the best, is that God will reward us in heaven. Now, this should never be the motivation, should it? This is simply the byproduct of what it is our heart has decided to do. Look what Matthew 25, verse 21 tells us. His Lord said to him, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You were faithful over a few things, and I'll make you ruler over many. Enter into the what? Joy of the Lord." The joy of the Lord. Think about this. How we spend our time in the here and now is what will determine what is going to be done for us in the next life of eternity. Jesus said, "You've been faithful in little things, and I'll put you in charge of many. Enter into the joy of the Lord." Can I ask you a question? Isn't that the greatest motivation of life? That somewhere along the way, if I am willing to serve my brother and sister, if I am willing to do as Christ says, I am doing it unto the Lord in such a way that He will give me a reward. Now, you know the story. It's recorded for us in the book of Matthew, Matthew chapter 7. It's a very, very powerful story. The Bible tells us in verse 21, "Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only he who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. Many will say to me on that day, 'Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? Did we not drive out demons and perform miracles?' And then Jesus will plainly tell them, 'I never knew you. Apart from me, you evildoers.'" I just want to tell you something. We toss out, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant," like it's going to be handed out like chocolate. But I'm here to tell you, I believe those words are going to be reserved for those who truly demonstrate it, not just as a token given as grace. But there will be nothing better when you and I enter into heaven but to hear the words of our Master. Danny, Curtis, Shirley, Sandra, Larry, Suzanne, whoever it might be, "Well done. Well done, thou good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of the Lord." I want to share a little story with you in closing. And I hate Rick couldn't be here this morning because it talks about the astronauts, which he loves so much. If you'll go back, for those of you who were around back in 1971, from July 26th to August the 7th, the eyes of our nation were pinned to that little black and white television as Apollo 15 made their moon mission. David Scott and James Irvin covered nearly 17 miles of the surface of the moon in a specialized vehicle that they dubbed the moon buggy. You got a picture of it there. When Apollo 15 was on its way back to Earth to splash down and be retrieved, James Irvin in his journal wrote these statements. You might not be able to read it, so let me just read it to you. "Being on the moon had a profound spiritual impact upon my life. But before I entered space with the Apollo 15 mission in July, I was a lukewarm Christian, to say the least. I was even a silent Christian, but I feel the Lord sent me to the moon so I could return to Earth and share about His Son, Jesus Christ. The entire space achievement is put in proper perspective when one realizes that God walking on the Earth is more important than man walking on the moon. I believe that God walked on the Earth 2,000 years ago in the person of Jesus Christ. I have totally yielded my life to the Lord's service to tell people everywhere about the life-changing message of Christ." Friends, have you ever thought that your mere act of service might help someone encounter that very truth? Join me as we pray. Father, I simply pray in these few moments that we might really reflect upon what's going on within us. And there's nothing wrong with acknowledging that maybe just maybe our first response isn't always to serve, but rather to be served. But Christ would have us think. He's given us something in which we are to follow because he set the example. So how many times in each and every day do we begin to think about those in whom we can serve? How many times when we're walking to and fro do we begin to think about opportunities that you put before us as opportunities to serve? Oh, Father, only heaven will reveal what our attitude and desire to serve will have done to shape the lives of others. May we take what James Irwin shared and apply it to our life so that we, who maybe at times are silent and maybe even categorized as lukewarm, might begin to be a little bit more bold about the way not only do we say we believe in you, but the way we demonstrate that and the way we live our lives, caring in community for others, but demonstrating that by serving the needs of them. Speak to us now, O Lord, as we surrender it all into your care. We ask this in your name. Amen. As they come in these few moments, y'all go and come. I just want to challenge you with this thought. Sometimes if you're like me, you don't know where to begin. So don't get all worried about the 20 people or the 15 people or the 10 people. As the old saying goes, what one thing today, what one thing this week could you do that in doing it faithfully unto the Lord, he might allow to be used as serving? And in serving, open up the heart and mind of another to encounter life-changing truth of the gospel. Spend this time committing that unto the Lord. Sure. Hear that, they've gone on their honeymoon to serve the Lord on mission. What a blessing.
Surrender all.
To a passage of scripture that Jimmy read, because I truly believe that as a church, as a body, we should be always first grounded in the Word, because if we're not, then what we do from here is going to be in vain. It's going to be disconnected from the truth. So verse 17 of chapter 13 in John, this is Jesus. Now that you know these things, you will be blessed if you do them. Now that you know all of what Jimmy has said as we journeyed through the Word together, now that you have seen and remembered the example of Christ, we all will be blessed if we do them, if we find that one person. And yes, this means that person that you maybe don't like, that person that doesn't like you. And in those times where maybe you have a fear or a lack of knowledge of how to serve that person, let your love for Christ overcome that. Let the spirit that's living within you overcome that. Go and do likewise. Join with me as we pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, I pray that your word spoken today, Lord, wouldn't return empty, Father. But Father, we would take your truth. Father, we would live it out. And when we do so, that we would, Lord, continue abiding in you. Because Father, service for just service's sake, there is no fruit and no life in that. But Father, it is through abiding in you, in your Son Jesus, in your Word. And Father, the love that we've experienced so overflowing in our lives that we are compelled to show others, to serve others, to allow others to come in contact with you through our works, through our intentions. The Father, I pray that as we sing this song of dismissal and as we leave here today, Father, that we would be vessels worthy to be used by you. Father, and I pray that this week that we would find that one person and pour out to them the love that you have continuously showed us. Especially those who we think don't deserve it, because the truth is we don't deserve it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'm gonna lay
burdens down by the riverside, down by the riverside, down by the riverside. I'm gonna lay down my burdens down by the riverside and study war no more. I ain't gonna study war no more. Gonna study war no more. I ain't gonna study war no more. I ain't gonna study war no more. Ain't gonna study war no more. I ain't gonna study war no more. I'm gonna talk to King Jesus down by the riverside. The riverside, down by the riverside. I'm gonna talk to King Jesus down by the riverside and study war no more. I ain't gonna study war no more. Ain't gonna study war no more. I ain't gonna study war no more. I ain't gonna study war no more. Ain't gonna study war no more. Ain't gonna study war no more. I'm gonna lay down my burdens down by the riverside, down by the riverside, down by the riverside. I'm gonna lay down my burdens down by the riverside and study war no more. I ain't gonna study war no more. Ain't gonna study war no more. Ain't gonna study war no more. I ain't gonna study war no more. Ain't gonna study war no more. Ain't gonna study war no more. I'm gonna talk to King Jesus down by the riverside, down by the riverside, down by the riverside. I'm gonna talk to King Jesus down by the riverside and study war no more. I ain't gonna study war no more. Ain't gonna study war no more. Ain't gonna study war no more. I ain't gonna study war no more. Ain't gonna study war no more. I ain't gonna study